Good morning, everyone. And welcome to worship this beautiful day. I think it's very nice of you guys to organize good weather. Somebody clearly has a good word up. I've been on the road a few times to New Brunswick the last few days, and I'm usually very sensible and don't try to travel to New Brunswick in January. But so far I've had an ice storm and a snowstorm and a windstorm with rain. But whenever I've been here, it's been real nice. So I think it's working out. I have a small rant I have to share with you, which is to say, women's clothing do not have pockets. Have you noticed that?
Yes.
I've clearly hit a nerve in a certain quarter here. I came this morning and I knew I had no pockets, and then I got here and I looked at my little box for my microphone and I thought that was why I needed something with pockets. So if you wonder why I'm carrying my own leash this morning, that's because I don't have a pocket to put it in. And if you hear a little crash, I'm sure it'll be all right. We got carpets here and it won't be too much of a bang. Well, so welcome to worship. This is God, the community of God's saints. In this place, love and memory are held in sacred tension. And we hear again the story of Jesus and his people and the prophets reinterpreted for our own age. You are welcome no matter what you bring here, no matter where you come from, no matter what you've done or not done. We are here in a place of rest to hear the stories of a God who loves us more than we love ourselves. And if you are a visitor here today or you sit here every single week, you count as equal in God's kingdom. Welcome to everyone. We'd like to acknowledge the territory that we have here, that we live and work on the unceded territory of the Mi'kma'ki people. And we owe a debt to their generosity and history of sharing that we cannot repay. So let us always remember when we come here that we must live in right relationship with all God's people, continuing to work towards the reconciliation, which even our own government has said is important, and each day hoping to get stronger in our relations with all the people who live in this land. And in that spirit, and in that knowing of our debt to those who have come before us, in the land and in the faith, we light this candle, which reminds us that even when we can't see it, the light of Christ is with us, and it is what brings us together as the people of God. And to also remember that all God's people come together in that same invitation, and that ultimately the goal of being Christians together is that all may be one in all their glorious diversity, and each one of us accepted as a beloved child.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship today. Our gathering sounds is the same as last week, which is this beautiful hymn, the third verse of Come Touch Our Hearts, which says, Come Touch Our Minds. Please stand.
Invited into a strange world, you and I, where birds sing for joy and there is no want and no need, and all our debts are forgiven. Our hearts yearn for this place, the kingdom of God. Enter into it, be bold, and trust the promises, and you will find so much more than you could have imagined. Let's pray together our prayer of reconciliation. How quick we are, O God, to demand what we are owed.
Forgive us our debts.
How slow we are, O God, to remember what we owe to others.
As we forgive our debtors.
We acknowledge, O God, that in your economy, our debts and debtors are bound together.
What happens to one happens to the other.
Teach us to level the playing field.
So that all may be one. Amen.
Forgiveness is not in short supply in God's economy. All are in need, and all receive. From a God who desires nothing more than the beloved world should at last be reconciled. Thanks be to God. Amen. We're going to sing our opening hymn, number 291 in Voices United, All Things Bright and Beautiful.
Wonderful in love, God made it all. Today's reading is Matthew 6, 7 to 21, New International Version. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only to your Father, who is unseen. And your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moss and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moss and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Also from Matthew 25 to 34. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you be worrying at a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or where shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own.
Okay, now I feel really guilty for worrying that my dress doesn't have pockets. Let us pray. Oh God, you've given us this beautiful world. You have given us this beautiful word. May we bring the world and the word together and hear what your Spirit is saying to the church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When I was a kid, my mother used to say prayers with me every night before we went to bed. There was a whole sort of bedtime ritual, and that was the last bit of it. And so when I was a very small child, we said that classic children's prayer. You probably know it too. Now I lay me down to sleep. Yep. Said it with her every night, and then we gave blessings for all my family members, including the ones I probably had never even met, I think. There may have been a tactic to keep my mother there a little longer. I mean, you can't rule it out. And you know, I didn't realize until much later, if you kind of continue through to the end of the prayer, you get to the very end, the last line, if I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. It's like, who says that to a kid? Maybe that was more of a concern in earlier centuries when child mortality was so high, but trust me, by the time we get to the 1960s, it wasn't so bad. And if you follow the history of the hymn books and how we do these sorts of things, you might remember that this is very much akin to some of the lines of Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me still when I'm very weak and ill. Or the last line, if I love him when I die, he will take me home on high. The original poem that Jesus Loves Me is based on was actually written as a prayer for a child who was dying. But somewhere around 1973, when we got the new Red Hymn Book, those lines were softened a little for kids, and I like the hymn a lot better now. But in any case, when I was, 6 years old, I didn't think about that at all. But what I did think about as I got a little bit older was, now I lay me down to sleep as a child's prayer, and I'm very grown up now, probably all of 8. And therefore, I should pray a grown-up's prayer. And so, being a good churchgoer, and I had been going to church for a good long time at that point, I decided to pray the prayer that all the grown-ups prayed every time we were in church. You know the one, right? Lord's Prayer. And so every single night, I would say the Lord's Prayer to myself. And one of the things I realized, this is me telling on myself, I've got two tells on myself to give here. One of them is, as I became an adult and started praying to that prayer together in church, I discovered I couldn't get through 3 lines without yawning. I think it's because I said it at bedtime every night, right? And I had to really work to suppress the yawns. And now you're all going to watch now, right, for the Lord's Prayer to figure out whether I yawn in your company. I think I've got it under control now. But the other thing that happened with the Lord's Prayer with me is I got further into my ministry. And of course, I'm now the one leading the Lord's Prayer every Sunday. So there I'm standing one day in my first pastoral charge as a young mom. And trying to keep a lot of things together, and who knows where my thoughts were coming, but I'm sitting there praying, give us this day our daily bread, and then I couldn't remember what came next. And you'd think that would just be one day, but it started happening all the time. I mean, there was the one time where I circled around and prayed like another line at some point, and you could hear the kind of atmosphere in the room going, what did our minister just do? But I said, I like that line so much, I prayed it over again. And most of the time when you're praying the Lord's Prayer, there's a whole lot of people saying it with you. And I always back off from the microphone a little bit to let the people's voices speak. But it's almost like there was somewhere in there, somewhere in the 90s or 2000s, a little connection in my brain stopped connecting. And a prayer that I had prayed forever. Actually, I can do it if I just go and don't think. It's when I stop to think that I get myself in trouble. So give us this day our daily bread. What's the line I'm forgetting? Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, indeed. I've had an occasion to think about that line a lot, I mean, because of my own little memory loss. But I've realized the more I think about that line, the line that I forgot, the more I realize that maybe that line is one of the most important lines of all. And the fact that I forgot it has brought my attention to it, and because of that, I'm kind of grateful. I want to talk about that line in the prayer. And what I want to ask you is, why do we need to forgive each other our trespasses? Ever thought about that? Why is it trespassing that we're such a big deal? I don't know about you, but I mean, I don't usually walk on my neighbor's lawns, but occasionally when I do, they usually smile and wave instead of chasing me off with a shotgun. Maybe metaphorically, yeah. Yeah, I mean, metaphorically for what, do you think? People's feelings? Causing hurt to others. Causing hurt to others, yeah. Maybe I always took it as a synonym for sinfulness. Forgive us our sins. Yeah, exactly. But the interesting thing about this is, if you go to the Greek, the word that is there is not the word for sinfulness, and is not the word for mistakes or or even for trespasses. Like there's a Greek word that can be legitimately translated to trespassing, which means crossing a boundary, like going over the line. But the word that is there is, my Greek is not strong, I've got it phonetically, let's see how we go. Ophthalemata. Ophthalemata. Ophthale means debt. And when you read the scripture, what there was right in front of you was, forgive us our debts as we forgive those who owe us debts. I don't know if you noticed when she read the reading that that's not the word we're used to saying. Well, the word that you read is the good translation. That word is about debt and it's about money. It's not about sinfulness at all. When this collection of sayings that was put together that we think of as the Lord's Prayer, our thought is not that Jesus ever prayed that prayer in particular. Our thought is that the collectors came later with a bunch of his sayings and put a whole bunch of things he did say in a row and said, this is the kind of prayer that our Lord taught us, although it might have been said at different times in Jesus' mouth. It's all come together as a collection of Jesus' thinking. And in that collection, as it's there in the original Greek, it says, forgive us our debts. And whoever made the English translation of the version that we say in churches now wants to make it about our sins. It's the difference between being forgiven of sins and being forgiven of debts. I mean, I personally have come over the years to think that the reason why we use sins is because it's more comfortable for us. I think it's easier to forgive somebody else's sins, or even their mistakes, sometimes even their big ones, than it is to forgive what they owe us, particularly when it's money. I don't know about you, but I remember when somebody owes me money a lot longer than I remember if they happened to cross a boundary, say, or do something that hurts me. Like that kind of hurt usually can go fairly quickly if you've got a strong relationship. But it doesn't matter how strong the relationship, if they owe me money, I know. You know, and I also find it sometimes it goes along with the thing that I think, I actually think it's kind of evolutionary, that we grew up as a species, as all species, we're worried about where our next meal is going to come from. So if we've got a little extra, we don't necessarily want to share because it might be the difference between life and death. And Jesus knows that's in our nature. So what Jesus says is you've got to work on forgiving those debts. But it's not because it's good to do this. It's not because you're a good person if you forgive debts. It has to do with what kind of system you get, what kind of cultural system you get if you don't forgive debt. Jesus knew about that firsthand. I talked about it a little bit last week, but there was in Jesus' time an enormous debt crisis in Judea and Galilee, the Palestine area. It came about because of the expansion of the Roman Empire, which to that date was the largest empire that had ever existed in the history of humanity. Empires only can get so big because they end up running out of room. I mean, they didn't have instantaneous communication. Every message had to be run by a person from one place to another. So empires get only as big as communication and roads and stuff like that go. And the Roman Empire had the best engineers in the world, so they built the best roads in the world. They could get from one place to the other as fast as anybody. They were great organizers, so they had an amazing bureaucracy, very efficient, very able to remember what had happened in one place and send the kind of messages that kept the group together so that there was consistency from one place to the other. And the third thing they had that made their empire possible was the best army in the history of humanity up until that point. And so being that efficient and that strong and powerful, they expanded their empire through pretty nearly all of Europe. Apparently the Scots stopped them. Those naked guys painted blue scared the Romans so bad they built a wall and said, nobody's going there. But they went that far into Europe, they went into Asia, They went into Asia Minor, down Turkey. They did pretty much all of North Africa, the Africa above the Sahara. They pretty much owned all of it. They were the most fearsome empire of their day, but running an empire like this takes a lot of money. So what they did, in order to be able to finance these good roads and this great bureaucracy and this amazing army, was every time they conquered a nation, they taxed the heck out of it. Am I allowed to say heck in church? Okay. If you want to use a different word, you can actually substitute your own. That works. Whoops. I keep knocking these buildings over. Kind of like Godzilla in the village, but anyway. Or maybe like the Roman Emperor, the biggest bully in the neighborhood. So what had happened in probably about 50, 60, 70 years before Jesus was born, they had conquered Judea, and they conquered it the usual way that they did, which is to say they bought the king. So they bought King Herod, and Herod went on his knees, his hands and knees, to the Roman Emperor and said, I will be your man and govern this so well if you just give it to me. So first, King Herod is the king, and the Roman Empire says, sure, we'll just bankroll you. And then his sons were one by one taken out of power, and by the time we get to Jesus, we're just about at the point where it's being run directly by a Roman governor who has a fabulous palace, who needs some money to be able to do that. So the money came from taxes of the conquered people. They taxed them so heavily. Over the very rich people had enormous taxes. It was all based on how much property you had. And so what they were doing is they were calling in the debts of their neighbors to be able to pay their taxes. And the moderately wealthy people were having a hard time paying their taxes. So what they did is they called in their debts from all the little shopkeepers and owners and little farmers that owed them some money. And the little shopkeepers and owner, or little tiny farmers, and they called in all of their debts as well. But eventually we got to a point where the debt could not be paid. There was not enough money to be able to go around. And what ended up happening is people had to sell their farms. And I was doing ministry as a student minister about the time, just after the great farm crisis, after the banks loaned all the money to farms. And good farmers were said, you know, you've got to get big. If you don't get big, then you won't be able to compete in today's market. And so they loaned these farmers, based on the collateral of their land, enormous amounts of money, well beyond any expectation of the farmers being able to earn that money. And when the banks realized that they had loaned too much money, they foreclosed on the loan, and farmer after farmer lost their farm. It's exactly the same process. But with a twist, because in Israel, under the law of Moses, every family who was part of the covenant of the Israelite people with God had a family farm that was theirs, that was their birthright, that could never be sold, that could never be taken away, because they knew that feeding the children of those farmers was more important than rich people getting richer. And even if, for some reason or other, the farm kind of had to be sold, or there was kind of some ways in which that could be done, but you couldn't sell the farm forever, you could only sell it for a few years, and then it would be returned to the family. So that if your dad, say, was really bad at managing his money, he wouldn't then make your children starve. It was an amazing system. It was really wonderful. And then the Romans came in and said, we consider land to be nothing other than a commodity. Of course you can sell it to pay your debts. And Jesus and his people remembered the covenant of God, which the Romans were ruining with indebtedness. And those little farmers who went off their land, they had three options. The first option was that they could become a day laborer. You know those stories that Jesus says where the people are standing around waiting for a day's work? That's what Jesus and his dad did every day. They walked 10 miles or thereabouts. I keep forgetting. It's an amazing number and I can't believe it. They get up in the morning before dawn. They would walk to the neighboring city, which the Romans were building for the rich people who could still afford to buy property. They would wait around hoping to be employed that day, but no guarantee they would. And then when they were done, with money or without, they'd walk home, do it again the next day. That's the day laborer. If you've got a little skill, you can do that. Like, that's, Jesus was a carpenter. So with his dad, they had a way to be able to make money, but some people didn't even have that. So if you weren't good enough to be a laborer, you became a beggar in the street. And you might notice there are a lot of beggars in Jesus' stories too, right? And we keep running into them. In fact, in some of the stories about Paul, there we see beggars in the street. So common. Jesus would have walked by them every day. The third thing that people would do if they were thrown off their land and had no money is they would become bandits in the hills. And what they would do, this is the most desperate choice of all, is that they would assault or possibly even murder people to get their money, because otherwise there was no way that they could live. And the average length of time that bandits lived in the hills around Galilee, hey, you know those bandits are in stories that Jesus tells too. Isn't that what the Good Samaritan is all about? The average lifetime of those bandits who did that was about 18 months. Because about every 18 months, the complaints of the wealthy people being attacked on the road would get so strong that the Romans would send their soldiers in, find the bandits, kill them. But funny, with the debt crisis going on, there was always more, because there were always people who were that desperate. This was Jesus' everyday life. We're not talking about, something that, he could ignore. It's something that was a part of his everyday life. And Jesus knew, as his people knew, in his bones, that this is being caused because somebody, a very wealthy man who could well afford to forgive a debt, is getting that money out of a very poor person who cannot. And so that forgiveness for Jesus is not religious. It's about people's living. It's about restoring the fabric of society. It's about going back to that system that the covenant of Moses created so that no child would go hungry. I go back to that over and over again, and Jesus did too. But something happened in 312. In 312, the Emperor Constantine, who had been hedging his bets about which religion he was going to follow, he in fact made up four flags of four different religions and went out as emperor, or maybe just before he was emperor, to have a battle. And he figured whichever banner he won the battle under would be the god that was all powerful, and that's the one he would follow. And which one do you think he won under? The cross. His big battle, he won under the cross, and he said, obviously that God is the right one. I shall be a Christian now, and not only that, because I'm emperor, you guys are all going to be Christians too. So now the wealthiest man in the world is a Christian. How do you think he's going to feel about debt forgiveness? Everybody owes money to him. Why would he want to see debt forgiveness? And over the years, between there and now, something that we call Christendom, where the where Christians are undetectable from the nations of the world, every king who's been a Christian has felt very similarly. I am the king, why would I forgive debts? Or, we get to places that don't have kings, and you maybe get to the point where they say, I am the president, and why should I forgive debts? When those of us who have means and wealth look at the gospel can be distorted. And that's why I think it was possible when the English language version of the Lord's Prayer was created, that word debt was kind of crossed out. Instead, we talk about sins, because sins are easier to forgive than debts. And now as we come to the end of Christendom, as no longer are we necessarily a Christian nation, and no longer are our rulers necessarily Christian, we live in a capitalist society where the entire system is built on debt. Maybe systems have always been built on debt. It's entirely possible. But in our particular case, the model of growth that goes through capitalism is driven by the fact that you've got capital that you lend to another person and they pay you back in interest. So now you've got a little more money than you did before to lend out to the next guy who pays you back with interest, and then you got a little more. And that's actually not such a bad system, because if you're lending out your capital to people who are actually able to make things they wouldn't be able to make without, they do get a little richer. They are able to pay the money back. That's not actually the complaint that I have. The complaint that I have right now is that we've got billionaires now who, how was it said? I think along the lines of Elon Musk could, if he chose, pay off the debt of everybody in the world. We've got this incredible, I mean, Musk could, and Jeff Bezos could. Gates at least is trying to find a drug for malaria and do a couple other things like that. But, I mean, it's still true that these very wealthy people have so much more money than they actually need, that we're getting back to the place where the big guys who could well afford to forgive debts are nevertheless demanding the money from the small people who can't. And when we start talking in our culture about things along the lines of guaranteed income for people, that wasn't that good during the pandemic? That every single person, pretty much, who got thrown out of a job because of the pandemic had a guaranteed income? I know people for whom that guaranteed income made possible not just eating, not just, you know, living, but also being able to be creative and be able to, you know, for people who have some ability issues where, you know, their disability means they can't work regularly, it means there's a regular income. I'm a big fan. The United Church, by the way, is promoting it. Even Hugh Siegel, a conservative senator, is standing up there saying it's a good idea. Why do you think they're saying it's a good idea? Because if everybody has enough to eat, the economy works better. I mean, this is practical stuff. And, you know, it may seem really weird that I'm standing here in the middle of a church talking about economics. But I want to tell you, Jesus said more about economics than he did about just about anything else in the entire gospel. He had almost nothing to say about sex. And what are we in the church obsessed about? Why? Because if you keep your focus on that obsession, you may miss what Jesus is actually saying. Are you piling up your treasure on earth, or are you piling up your treasure in heaven? Do you actually have enough to live? Why are you still worried about this? If you have enough money and somebody else doesn't, forgiving their debts can make a bigger difference to their life. And if you make a big enough difference to their life, our whole community would be strengthened. That's what Jesus was teaching about money. But we've forgotten. We've put it in the realm of morality. We've gotten into the business as a church of saying who's right and who's wrong, who's sinful and who's blessed. I want to say, I don't think Jesus cared about that stuff at all. What Jesus cared about, what our God cares about is, does that child have enough to eat today, or does that child go to bed hungry? I don't want to say it's the only thing we care about, but if you go into Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which talks about you got to have your basic needs satisfied before your bigger needs can actually be worked on. If our real goal as a society is to continue to create beautiful new products, beautiful new art, beautiful new structures that make sure that everybody is fair, to be able to do that, you got to do the most basic thing, which is to make sure they've got food, shelter, security, all those kinds of stuff. That's the stuff that Jesus was preaching about. And the reason he preached about it, because he lived in a society where so many people did not have it, that he wanted a world where that was no longer true. And that is still our vision. Is that not still our vision? We are here for it. And what I want to say, as Christendom kind of disappears, as no longer is there a link between the rulers of the land and our faith, we have a unique opportunity here to be countercultural. As I'm saying, late-stage capitalism is kind to no one. And us who have a memory of the stories that Jesus taught about the basics of making sure people have enough to eat and shelter over their head and enough clothes to wear and having those things so that they can live well, we can remember those stories for this culture. Because the thing that Jesus knows about these stories, the thing that's right there in the Bible and a little bit of the history I've given you a little bit of a preview about, is that story did not end well. It didn't even end well for the Roman Empire. You know what happened after Constantine became the emperor and became Christians and, and continued on into the rest of that fourth century, is that they didn't repay their debts. They didn't even pay their army very well anymore. And when they stopped paying their army very well, what ended up happening if you were a Roman soldier from... Oh, and Roman soldiers were no longer Roman, because none of those wealthy men wanted to send their sons to war. So they got the barbarians up there to be able to come in and fight for them. And they paid them so badly that it was a very short time before the Romans, before the Roman army made of barbarians realized they made better money from sacking Rome than they were getting paid by Rome to be a soldier. So guess what they did? They sacked Rome. They did it three times before Rome fell. You see, because that story never ends well. And we, as a church, have the possibility to remember a different story, to be able to talk about how it is that we can have a story where all are included, and where everyone is a part of God's kingdom, and where debts are forgiven, not because it benefits you, but because it also benefits me. If we live in the kind of world where we're invested in the kingdom and invested in the people around us, we may have a little less money if we forgive debts, but what we will have is better connections. And like we discovered during the pandemic, like we discovered during Fiona, like we discovered during all these sorts of things, having that community to surround us is way more important than having money, because you can't eat money. Let us carry this memory. Let us preach this from the hills. Let us go out and demonstrate. Let us be the people who paved the way for our society to become a more just society. Let us forget that we were once powerful, and let us speak with the voices of the people. And I think maybe if we do a little more of this and catch a few more people with the vision, our kids want to hear this message, by the way. Our kids live this. You just go listen to a millennial and see what they think about debt. Then we will be finding that road that Jesus showed us towards the kingdom. Amen. So our next hymn is number 291 from Voices United. Oops, no, wrong one. 356 from Voices United. Seek ye first the kingdom of God.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God.
So as the first sign of that economy of God, where all have enough and those who have share with those who do not, we bring our offering forward to be received. Let's try that again with the microphone. Extravagant God, you have promised a treasure in heaven that outweighs any we could envision or imagine here on earth. Help us to be grateful for the amazing gifts you have already given to us, and help us to share them with the world. Amen. Thanks, Bruce. Please be seated. So as we approach the prayers of the people this week and have the Lord's Prayer after, I went looking for a version of the Lord's Prayer that was specifically put economically. Think about it in real world money. And I came up bare on a Google search, and I said, why not go for the simple thing? And this might take you out of your comfort zone, and if it does, good. Instead of praying, we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer the way that you pray it every Sunday, except when we get to the word trespasses, we're going to substitute it with debts and debtors. And I want you to pay a little bit of attention as we say that prayer, how that makes you feel. And I think maybe calling some attention to some of those real world money problems, as Jesus was originally doing, might be outside our comfort zone, but I really feel it's where the church is called to be, to get with those original Greek words and maybe what Jesus' original message was. If you're having trouble remembering, the words are going to be up on the screen. They even underlined debtors and debt and debtors, so you won't miss it. Let us pray. Oh God, you who love this world so well, who sent us the prophets and the preachers, and even Jesus, to remind us that we need to love that world as well. We bring our broken hearts to you, knowing that we have not always been so good at debt forgiveness, and yet knowing that in Jesus and in his words, following in the traditions of the prophets of the Hebrew people, it's possible to do community better. So God, in these times when we're all kind of divided up into our own little spaces and our own little places, and we're reaching out seems harder than ever, let us remember that we are a people who are meant to live in community. And that community is worth work. And so we pray that you may give us the strength and maybe even more importantly, the openness to build connections wherever we may find them, to trust a little, to take a risk, to be with somebody and hear the story of somebody who is not like us, to be able to open our community to the wider community, not just our church people and the ones we've always known, but to welcome the stranger and the orphan as the prophets commanded. And do all this, O God, not because you commanded it, but because to do community in this debt forgiveness way, in this eat and drink without price way, in this I have a little, let me share it with you kind of way, you have a little, I will let you share with me kind of way, is the kingdom of God that your prophets have preached about since the beginning. We pray, O God, that this inheritance that we have may be how we live in the world, not just for the world's sake, but also what it can do to us. For when that community is strong, we will bind others' wounds and they will bind ours. We will pay each other's debts and they will pay ours. We will all, when we have a need, find strength and blessing in that community. Oh God, may it be so, and may our yearning hearts be able to take one tiny step this week to be able to get us closer to the place where indebtedness is gone and we are just a community being together. We pray this in the strong faith of Jesus, who taught his people to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thanks for indulging me. I want to remind you that we've got coffee downstairs after the service, and we invite you all to be there and enjoy a few treats. I wanted to also mention, probably most of the players know, but we're going to be having a worship meeting today after service. So where are we collecting, Byron?
The room beside downstairs.
Okay. Okay, I know that room well. Do we have time to grab coffee before we come?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah, very good. You just crack the whip and tell us when we need to be there.
12 o'clock.
Also, the UCW are meeting on February 6th. It's hard to believe that that's like next week. But here we go. There are memorial donations up on the screen that are going around, but I also was asked to remind you that the food bank downstairs is still looking for empty glass jars and would gratefully receive some donations of that. So you can drop them off at the church or Tuesdays at the door of the parking lot, Tuesday mornings. Anything else anyone has?
Yes.
Good morning. Is this microphone on? Can you hear me?
Well, Byron's moving around. Maybe we can get it.
Have to change your hat. Try it now. Is that better? Good morning. Thank you for your message, Reverend Fraser, this morning. Classical Economics 101. I'm bringing an up-to-date, abridged version, I guess. I'm here on behalf of the committee that spearheaded the Step Up for Stairs campaign. Myself, Sandra, and Reverend Catherine, who's maybe watching this online later, to everybody that responded, thankfully, approximately 40 people did respond, or families, to increase their offerings to Stairs, either becoming signed up for PAR, or increasing their amounts from PAR, or their weekly or monthly offerings, or committing over certain times of the year to Step Up for Stairs. Thank you very much. The reason I'm speaking this morning is I've been looking at and preparing for next year's annual report, looking at the budget, and for the last several years we've had to dig into our investments and cash out our dividends to cover operating expenses, and that continues this year, of course. The year before last, the market was so strong, we recovered almost all of what we had to withdraw. Last year, not the same. The world markets were down overall. So it would be wonderful if additional people could step up for Stairs. Let's go for the number 50, from 40 to 50. If we can do that, it's very much appreciated. You'll all be receiving a personal thank you for that. So thank you for everybody that has stepped up for Stairs. Thank you.
I think we had another one over here.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
This is a message from the UCW. Don't budge. It's just a gentle nudge. And you don't have to make fudge. We're coming into another month, this coming week, and the month of February. And with the UCW, it's customary to have a bakeless bake sale. Now, I'll repeat that. It's a bakeless bake sale. So, there's no baking. There could be a little dipping. Now, this is a different kind of dipping. It's like dipping into your pocket, or your change purse, or your wallet, or even your checkbook. And we're saying this with all of the gratefulness and thankfulness that the UCW have for this congregation. So this is what you are asked to do if you choose to do so. And it's all inclusive. Everybody can participate. It's like our church, all inclusive. Everybody is welcome. So what you're to do is think about, what would I bake if it were a bake sale? Let me see. For me, it would be cinnamon buns. Okay. So when you think about what you would bake, think about the ingredients. What are they? And what they might cost today. Those ingredients might cost $5, they might cost $10, they might even cost a toonie. Whatever you think that you are able to give and are contemplating on what you might have done and thinking about how much fun it is to bake, really, but sometimes people get tired. And after Christmas, they're very tired. So all you have to do, if you choose, is to take an envelope, put a little something in it for the UCW towards their bakeless bake sale, which will continue through the month of February. And if you happen to be away during that period of time, you could do it now or later. It's always most welcome and gratefully accepted. Thank you.
There's a little poetry for your morning, too. And now I want cinnamon buns. Our closing hymn is Tumor 212 and More Voices. I've got Voices United in my manuscript, but it's More Voices. Sent forth in Jesus' name. I think if you've got the hymn book, we're going to sing it twice.
Oh, we're just going to do it.
Oh, just once? Oh, well.
Each section twice.
Our hands are raised.
after that, we need to do like a nice little samba, you know? Excellent. So now go forth into the world in the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit to fulfill your high calling as servants and friends and debt forgivers in the name of Jesus Christ. And may the living Christ go with you. May he go behind you to support you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, within you to empower you, and ahead of you to show you the way. Amen.